Nicholas Antonio, if I could you, I'm going to have you go to the podium. And we're, you know, this is a city that gets talked about for a lot of reasons. And sometimes we get talked about for our young people, and what we know is there are a lot of terrific young people in this community. And today we have a, I wanted to acknowledge Nicholas Antonio, who's a student at Hardin Middle School, who just recently participated in the National Youth Leaders Conference in Washington, D.C. I was impressed by the commitment your family made, and I hope you'll, when you address the council, will acknowledge your folks that six students were nominated for this honor at Hardin, and Nicholas and his family decided it was a terrific opportunity to build upon the fact you are already a student leader and go get some skills. And I happen to be very fond of the teacher who nominated you, but you earned this opportunity on the merits of the fact, and if you'll allow the affectionate use of the phrase, apparently you're a great kid. And it took a lot of courage to go all across the country by yourself, and we understand you learned a thing or two, and would like to hear about that, and really would like to acknowledge your efforts and point out that there are a lot of terrific young people in this community, and we can always be optimistic of the future because there are students like you coming up the ranks. So Nicholas, we really want to acknowledge the effort you made to try and improve yourself and bring those skills back to our community. So congratulations, and nice to see you.
Thank you.
Why don't you quickly tell us about your trip to Washington and how you got there, and make sure you thank your folks.
Thanks.
Okay. Well done. Mom and Dad, thank you.
Okay, first thing I gotta say is that the trip was great, actually. Sure. It was very pleasant. I liked the pretty much everything about it was great. I liked how pretty much what I learned there, everything, all the travel was, and also how much leadership skills I learned.
And you were able to learn them in Washington, D.C., of all places.
No, I learned extra ones.
Okay.
I actually learned more of them.
Very, very good. Well, we want to acknowledge the commitment you made, and we know the community is going to benefit it, and I understand you're going to be an Eagle next year.
Yep.
You're on your way to Alvarez. Okay. Very good. Okay, congratulations, and come on up. Sheila, is this? Okay. Yeah, I was curious why I didn't have any stuff. Okay. All right. All right. Sheila, you will be responding. You know, I assume we'll just kind of, let me know what entertainment will be for next council meeting. So we'll just keep showing off all the talented young people in this community, because we aren't going to run out. So with that, okay. All right. Where'd it go? All right, with that, we are going to proceed to the presentation portion of the meeting, and we are gonna get started with AMBAG, and we'll start with Jim PM. So Jim?
I don't have it. I'm going to pass on to Michael Ricker. Michael.
Mayor Donahue, members of the council. I guess I should say first, I'm a poor substitute for Jim, but let me start with this. Under your leadership, Mayor, the city has received over $1 million in federal energy grants to address more energy issues. With implementation, this project has the ability and the potential to reduce the city's energy consumption, its energy bill, by $300,000 annually, and in a one-time $100,000 rebate to the city. Perhaps as important, it has the potential to not only create jobs, but create job opportunities for people within the community. And lastly, energy efficiency has the potential to reduce our greenhouse gases. So these three things in tandem have often been called the triple bottom line. Here to talk about that, I'm very pleased to be able to present two speakers. The first is from ICLEI. ICLEI is an organization that, again, through your leadership, Mayor, we are one of 500 communities across the nation who are a member, and they are providing all these communities with technical expertise and advice on how to address complex issues that typical staff like myself grapple with poorly from time to time. So I'm very pleased to have them here. And I'm going to switch it up a little bit and have ICLEI present first, and then have Ambag present second. And these will be back-to-back presentations, and then the council has questions.
Right, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to also synthesize council question, public comment, and
okay.
So just for the record, that's how we'll handle that. Okay, good.
Let me introduce Amrutha Sadalkar from ICLEI. She is an associate with ICLEI in California. She has a master's degree in environmental engineering from MIT, and I'm going to have her present first, and then right after that, I'm going to have a voice that you are familiar with. Elizabeth Russell and Charlie Buck from Ambag will be presenting a report that they just completed on greenhouse gas inventory for the city of Salinas. So, Amrutha.
Thank you very much. Thank you to the City Council for this opportunity. We're very happy to talk about how ICLEI can provide added value to the City of Salinas, given that the city has already made considerable progress in sustainability planning and climate action planning. So. Just a very brief background on ICLEI before I get into the presentation. As Michael mentioned, we are a membership organization of local governments, and our goal is to enable local governments to achieve tangible improvements in sustainability planning and achieve real reductions in greenhouse gases. Again, as Michael mentioned, we have about 500 local government members across the US, out of which over 100 are in California. And overall, we represent more than 25% of the US population. I wanted to set the stage by talking a little bit about the regulatory drivers of sustainability and climate action planning, and this is particularly relevant in California with the expected impacts of regulation like AB 32, which, as we all know, requires the state of California to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to 1990 levels by the year 2020. And then we have SB 375, which calls for measures on sustainability and climate action planning in two particular sectors, transportation and land use. And finally, CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act, which, as we all know, the recent modifications to the guidelines that CEQA provides require the inclusion of climate change as one of the impacts that have to be considered as cities implement new projects, and a new project could be, you know, proposed development under a general plan update and things like that. And so there are all these motivations for local governments to embark on a climate action planning process and a sustainability planning process because the requirements requirements of these various types of regulation will trickle down to the local government level. And so we're really happy that the city of Salinas has taken leadership in initiating this process, and we look forward to continue to support the city's sustainability and climate initiatives. So in addition to regulatory drivers, turns out there are also plenty of economic drivers for sustainability and climate action, and I just wanted to point out a few recent reports on the expected impacts of AB 32 on the economy. And there's this one report by the California Department of Labor and Workforce and Development, which estimates that the implementation of AB 32 will lead to about a $74 billion increase in GDP and 89,000 new jobs via specific measures in all of these sectors that are listed here. Additionally, there are also impacts by, or there are also reports by the city of Berkeley, as well as UC Berkeley, which talk about the benefits of AB 32 in terms of public health and the extent to which costs associated with public health will also be reduced as a result of this form of regulation. So then, in light of all these statewide initiatives, you know, what is it that local governments can do in order to ensure compliance and in order to cut their own costs? Well, it turns out there are lots of things local governments can do, particularly within the realm of what is possible or what is in their control, or the sectors that are in their control. So sectors such as solid waste or the energy use of buildings, or, and to some extent transportation, can be modified to ensure not only environmental benefits, but also cost savings. And I wanted to give a few examples of cities that have implemented specific measures in energy or water use or transportation or solid waste to show real cost savings, which are by far the largest motivating factor for action given recent budget constraints. So this is a case study that was done by PG&E, who had worked with the cities of Oakland and San Francisco on replacing some of the streetlights in both cities. So the older HPS technology was replaced with more energy efficient LED technology. And as you can see, the magnitude of savings per fixture is pretty significant considering the total number of fixtures in each city. And overall, I mean, there are some conclusions to be made from these types of measures where measures focused on new construction tend to have a much shorter payback period, whereas measures on retrofitting tend to have a longer payback period. But this is just to point out that there are these programs available where certain measures to cut costs and reduce energy consumption are available, and the financing for such measures is available through private partners like PG&E, as well as regional organizations like AMBAG. And I think AMBAG is going to talk a little bit more about available financing for these measures. This is just some other examples from the city of Berkeley, for example. So again, retrofits on certain city-owned buildings in electricity use and natural gas use led to cost savings of $370,000. The city of Berkeley has also tried to engage youth in the community, where one of their programs offers summer trainings to youth to provide free hardware installations and education to the residents of the community. And the various actions that the California Youth Energy Services organization provided led to a savings of $199,000 over a short period. And again, these are summer programs where students participate as a summer job, essentially. And then some other examples as well of the city of San Jose that has converted some of its existing buildings to be LEED certified. And again, many of their measures tend to involve street lights or traffic lights, which can be considered the low-hanging fruit of energy efficiency measures, where there is an immediate payback and return on investment, and it leads to immediate and real cost savings. And then lastly, the last example I wanted to talk about was